Hey, welcome to the 99 here on air.
Hello.
Hey, Matt.
Hey, this is Darryl.
Darryl is in...
Darryl is in the soon-to-be...
Darryl Worley.
Hey, welcome, brother. How are you?
Doing good. How are you guys?
we are doing amazing. Thank you so much for calling in. We weren't expecting this, man. You caught us a little off guard, man.
I can call back at a different
No, no, no.
No, no.
You know
no.
how this goes, man. Gary Michaels is like, you know, he's directing everybody around the world. And so I called him first, and he goes, "You're not supposed to call me. You got to call them." I said, "Dude, I'm calling you to see if my service is working."
Well, let me give you a proper introduction. Yes. You know, 12, I'm going to let you give the introduction. Go ahead.
So... should I introduce you as the man that will soon have the number one song in the nation? Would that be appropriate?
I don't know, brother. Let's don't jinx it.
So,
but I sure hope you're right.
So we welcome Darryl Worley to the 99% Radio Network. Man, I'm really jazzy you called. So for those of you that need a reminder, maybe you're not old enough to recall or not, in 2003, Darryl put out one of the greatest songs ever called "Have You Forgotten?" And it tried to draw people together to bring people back to the feelings that we had in the immediate aftermath of 9/11, that sense of community that was brought about by September 11th. And that song rocketed straight up to number one because it hit everybody in this country, male, female, regardless of your yeah. culture or whatever. It brought Americans
iconic.
Together. It was an iconic song. And here, what, about 2 weeks ago now, Darryl, right around the 4th, he rewrote that song and re-released it called "Have We Forgotten?" And that song strikes just as the first one did 20 years ago. It's, in my opinion, strikes right to the heart
yeah.
of where we are today in America. We are divided. You have American against American. You have black versus white versus brown versus yellow versus green. Everybody seems to be at everybody's throat now. And this song recalls that time.
Darryl, what made you do the rewrite?
You know, man, we were just, to tell you the truth, it wasn't my idea. A buddy of mine approached me and said, you know, he said, it's 20 years, you know, you're in the middle of the 20th anniversary of Have You Forgotten? Well, the first thing he asked me was, what's the biggest thing, you know, that ever happened to you? And I said, you know, in my career? And he goes, yeah. I said, well, Have You Forgotten? And he said, you should think about writing a new lyric for what's happening in our country today and releasing it this year on the 20th anniversary. And I thought, well, he said when he first said it to me, he said, I looked at him like he had a horn growing out of his head. Cause I mean, you know, it's like, okay, I'm going to take this 7 week number one that the good Lord blessed us with and start messing around with it. I don't know. I said, I don't know, man, it's my crown jewel. I don't know if I want to take a chance on giving it the old black eye. And but the more he sold it, man, this guy's a great guy. His name's Noah Gordon, and we actually gave him some songwriter credit on this song for bringing us this idea. So my co-writer and I sat down and I just sold the whole idea to him the same way Noah sold it to me. He basically said, look, if you want to do something good for your country, and he said, and I know you love your country and I know you're a patriot, then do this, man, because it could bring about some healing. It could bring us as a people closer together, like, you know, and bridge the gap some. And so when and I talked about it, I said, okay, he goes, I don't know how we can't do it. He goes, you know what, if we don't do it now, after this idea was brought to us, he said, I'm not going to be able to sleep at night. So I said, well, here, check this out. I said, let's write the lyric. You know, nothing else really changes. And I said, if we don't like it, we'll throw it in a garbage can and nobody ever knows. And so, well, we wrote it, and it was not as easy to write as the first one because we really wanted to be sure we said things right. And we put it down, and I just looked at him, and I said, man, there's no way we can hide this. And so I took it to some labels, you know, and I just took it to the big players. I didn't mess around. I figured, you know, if you're going to do it right. And everybody that we played it for wanted to put it out. And so I picked Big Machine because, check this out, the people that are, you know, working the song right now, my new record label, if that's not bizarre, you know, I'm just signing a new deal I'm almost 60.
Well, congratulations. I mean, but...
Hey, hold on, Sideshow. Darryl, so you know, Sideshow is a 9/11 first responder. He's retired NYPD, and he was, at the time of 9/11, the fire chief at Farmingdale, New York, and responded. I didn't know if you knew that or not.
I've heard you guys enough, and I've heard and I heard him talking. I heard you guys and Gary talking about the song the other day, and some of the things he said. I said, you know what? It's people like that really got Have You Forgotten, and it's the same people that will get this song because we can't help but think about what's going to happen to this wonderful place that we call home if we don't figure this out.
Yeah. So. You know, I'll tell you right one thing is right after 9/11. We were still going through the pile, and the American flag was on every household, every car, every antenna, every building, every storefront had. And I'm getting chills, man, because I'm thinking about this song. You're really bringing me back, and wow, it's just overwhelming. But 30 days later, man, there was nothing, and then you came
same
out
way
with
down here, man.
Huh?
I mean, same way down here. I mean, I know, you know, of course, we're not a world apart, but we're a good ways apart. But I'm traveling those back roads going home that day that it happened, and it already looked like a parade route.
Yeah.
And a month or two later,
nothing.
You know, just you see the occasional flags flying on the houses that always had them, and the rest of it's gone.
Yep. And that's why your song has hit every first responder, every veteran, every patriot out there, because, man, it's not only the lyrics, man, it grabs you by your soul, it massages your heart, and it really brings you solace at points. It really makes you think, and it brings you to another level of life, man. You really knocked it out of the park with that one, and I'm not going to give away, but you have to go hear this next song, this remake, because it really, really grips you tight.
You know, hey, Darryl, you know, I heard your song when it first came out, listened to it by myself, heard it on the radio and whatnot. First time I ever saw the real impact of your song was 2 years ago. Sideshow and I, we do this 9/11 memoriam. We read all the names of all the first responders that perished that day, and we do it out right alongside Heroes Memorial Bridge between Rowlett and Rockwall, Texas. And we invited this guy. His name was Gabino Martinez, and he's famous for being a speed painter. And so he set up his easel and whatnot. And then
I know who that is. I know who you're talking about.
You know what I'm talking
about? Yeah.
So Gabino.
Yeah, he was on a cruise one time that we did. Yep.
Oh, wow.
Amazing, amazing guy. And he came out and he set up his easel. The first note hit and he started painting the Twin Towers.
We didn't know what he was painting.
We didn't know what he was going to do. We didn't know he was going to play that song. And we probably had, I don't know, 300-400 people there in that little pavilion area where we hold the memoriam at. And, man, you could just see those two things, him painting the towers and really in his painting bringing out the feelings of that day to your song.
Man, wow. It wasn't a dry eye.
It was, I was standing where I could see the whole crowd, and it was so emotional. It was one of those, it was a moment, and it was a
great moment. It was a beautiful moment.
Well, I've never even heard of anything like that. That's crazy. I would have loved to have seen that going down.
I think
we have video of it. We could send to you. We could send you a video.
Oh, yeah,
of it.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah, because I tell you, we had so many people. We had old Army veterans that were sitting in their uniforms in the front seat. In the front row,
you're
man.
Talking about Gabriel, right?
Not Gabriel, but there were a couple of old Army veterans there, back from the Vietnam era, and you know, Wow. You just seen them starting to tear up. And I don't know if it was the towers or the song, because the song impacted them as well, because so many people have forgotten about them.
Yeah.
You know, so it doesn't only impact 9/11. It impacts all our veterans from World War II to the Vietnam era to every war after that. We've forgotten. We have.
Yeah, all the way back to the Revolutionary War. I mean, we wanted that song to resonate with people that had family members. The Worley family has family members all the way back to that fought in the Revolutionary War. So it's just. You know, and I tell people today even about that song, Have You Forgotten? There's no rocket science in it. It means exactly what it says. And we just wanted people to remember. I mean, you think about all the people that have made huge sacrifices, life and limb, for our way of life and what we enjoy here in this nation. And, you know, we can't sweep those people under the rug and not remember their sacrifices. I mean, and there's idiots out there that would say that we should do that.
Yeah, and that, you know, we try to bring this out all the time that, you know, when someone passed away either by suicide, the ripple effect it has, the ripple effect, if someone dies in a line of duty or dies in war, man, it's not only that life that's taken, it's the person he knew, the connections he've made, the family members, the children, the cousins, the relatives, the friends, the acquaintances, the barber. It affects so many people. And that's why we say their names. That's why we say their names, so we don't forget.
That's a wonderful thing. You know what? It's so crazy you'd say that. I was on the Lou Dobbs show right after Have You Forgotten. It only took it 5 weeks to go to number one, so we were having trouble scheduling everything fast enough. But was on the Lou Dobbs show, and he asked me, I'm going to ask you several, you know, very pointed questions. But the main one was, he asked, why would you say, you know, in the lyric that if it was up to you, you'd play it, you'd show it every day, talking about the footage from 9/11. I said, you guys that want to take that off the TV, I can't speak for you, but I said, I came home one time when I was a younger man and found my best friend and roommate dead in my house from suicide.
Oh, my God.
And I said, so when you go through something like that, especially if you feel like maybe you could have helped if you had known the signs, what to look for. So I read several books after all that, and I'm thinking, man, if I'd have only known, you know. And I said, but guess what? I said, guess what? People who have lost someone, a family member, a friend, someone dear to them, what do you think the thing that they fear the most? And the thing that those people fear the most, according to people a lot smarter than me, is that all of us will forget about that person. And I said, when you start yanking it off TV as fast as you can, I said, every family member out there that loved those people that died are thinking, man, you guys are trying to make us forget about them quicker than it's going to happen anyway. And so I answered Lou's question on the show that day. And he did something really cool, man. My mom called me. He said, you see what Lou Dobbs did? And I said, no. She said, I'm telling you, he's a good man, and he's going to let the people decide. And he put up a poll at the end of his show, and it said, all the people that think that we should continue to play the footage from 9/11 and all the people that think that we shouldn't. And, dude, it was like by the end of the week on Friday, he showed the final results. It was like 87% of the people said that they should continue to show the footage, because there's all those people out there going, you know, what are you afraid of? Because this is what happened to our loved ones.
Yes.
You know,
hey, Darryl,
they don't want that to be forgotten.
I don't, Darryl, are you watching us or are you just on the phone? I don't know if you, are you seeing the show
live? I'm on the phone. Yeah, I'd give anything if I was watching you guys. I mean, we got service good enough now, we might be able to pull it up.
Okay. Well, you can't see him, but sitting here in the studio with us right now is a Native American warrior, Gabriel Joseph. He was with the 82nd Airborne and 5th Special Forces, Gabriel, right? Tell him so I get it right. I want to make sure I got it right.
I was with the 82nd Airborne Division and 1st 75th Rangers.
With the Army Rangers.
Oh, got you.
Yeah. So
got you, man. I think I've heard your name and maybe heard a couple of stories about that guy. Some friends of mine. I wound up being in the war zone with the 82nd a whole bunch of times. I think you're talking to a fellow there that's pretty well known.
So he was whispering to me as you were talking with Sideshow about your song and the impact, and he whispered over to me. He goes, you know, in 2003 he was over in Iraq and he made the comment that they were questioning exactly why are we here, and then that song came out and there were no more questions about why they were there.
Wow,
that's impactful.
That those guys did something so special for me. We came into Mosul, and they immediately took us to a memorial service that was happening, and that was very sobering and a somber experience. That was early on in my journeys overseas to the war zone. But they took us back to the big complex where all the big brass hangs out and all that. They have a huge room there where they do kind of, conference room type thing, but it holds a lot of people. It's almost like a theater. Mm-hmm. And the 82nd Airborne Acoustic Choir vocal group came in and marched up to the front, and they did my song, Have You Forgotten, a cappella.
Wow. Oh, wow.
And I can't hardly talk about it.
Wow.
I didn't hear that one.
I mean, it was just unbelievable.
That's a song that's gonna, and this we could discuss about, 12. We were talking about this the other day. You were going through one of those old cemeteries. You were traveling. You found an old cemetery, and you looked at the kicked over tombstones, the buried tombstones. And we pass these places every day, and we look, and we're like, oh, it's just a old abandoned cemetery, but no, that's somebody's father, brother, sister, mother. Child.
Oh, yeah.
And when you said, Darryl, when you turned around and said they took it all off our TVs, that was so true, because I remember back they said we got to stop showing this, we got to stop showing the footage.
Yep.
It's got to be taken off, and the news finally stopped doing that. We have to keep these things up close and personal, man, because that's our history. Those are people that we love.
Amen.
They were somebody's family member there,
and
we cannot erase our history.
No.
So I thank you from the bottom of my heart, bro, for putting these lyrics down on paper and bolting it out and being a voice and being that person that can really speak for all of our veterans, our first responders, and those who have lost, because we will never forget.
Well, man, I'm gonna tell you, they wouldn't even think about letting people like myself put those messages out there if it weren't for people like you guys that are helping us to drive it home, because I don't expect that we'll have as much, flack, we had. I mean, it was really not that much on Have You Forgotten, because I think people across the board kind of felt the same way. It really wasn't anything that was polarizing. I mean, I had a few, there's always going to be a handful of people that are going to get up in arms about something because they just have to do that.
Right. Lots of Karens song, out there.
Yeah. I think this song for today, though, I believe it'll be even less polarizing. I mean, we felt compelled to use some pretty intense language in that first original song because we needed to get people's attention. This time, I mean, who can deny what this song's saying? I mean, we're in the worst place we've ever been as a people.
Yeah. And
prayerfully, there'd be a way that this song could maybe help somehow to just at least, if if it just makes people think about it. Like, I mean, honestly, Wynn and I sat down to write this. It took several meetings of us getting together. And I'm going to tell you something. We came to some real harsh realities in the midst of all this. And I told him, I looked him in the eyes and said, you know what? There's no doubt I've been part of the problem. And I mean, I don't mind saying it because I'm a stubborn-headed jackass sometimes, and I'm not, you know, and I don't like people, you know, pushing ridiculous agendas down my throat, and I don't like the way it's going to affect my family and my daughter in the future. So I step up and I'll get right back in their faces, and I know that sometimes because we have to deal with all that, you know, we just get real rigid and we don't have any capacity for moving toward the middle a little bit, and I think we got to all get over that. I think we're gonna have to be willing to hear our fellow man out, listen to his thing, and say, you know, I can't live with that, or I can compromise, and gonna take some of that because that's how we got to where we are to start with.
Well, brother, I think this new song, the new remake, is going to hit our the generation, this new generation, this younger generation, you know, that doesn't watch the news. They got everything on TikTok and Instagram and everything else. You know, I think this is going to hit rejuvenate a lot of our younger kids and really let them do some soul searching and look into themselves. And those who feel it will feel it. Those who don't will not. They just aren't.
They're not American.
They're not American,
they have
man.
The right not to like it, but they're
right.
Not American.
Exactly. But you know what? I'm glad you re-released this because I think a lot of our younger generation is going to feel this 100%.
Thank you so much, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
I appreciate you guys. You guys had some really wonderful things to say about the original song and the new version the other day when I was listening to y'all and Gary and. And it means the world to me because, you know, I mean, honestly, that's how these songs eventually reach the ear canals of the people in America. And we can't do it without you guys. So thank you for the positive words. And it means the world to me. And I love what you guys do. Man, To our friend there with the 82nd Airborne and Ranger, thank him for his service, and also, you know, you got a guy sitting in there that has been a police officer and a firefighter. That's going on right here on the home front every single day, and man, what our first responders are dealing with this day and time is pretty doggone intense. So. Special thanks to them too.
Yes, sir. And listen, if you ever traveling through Texas, please be you have an open invitation to the 99 at any time. We will play your songs loud and proud, as always, brother. And hopefully one day we could sit back, kick back, and have a cold one with you.
That'd be awesome. I'll be listening to you guys, and when we get down that way, I'll holler at you, especially when we're going to be in your neighborhood. And if we're playing around there, you guys can come out and hang out with us.
We would love that.
I just had an idea. If you're ever in DFW around the time of 9/11, how great would it be to have Gabino? And by the way, I sent you that video, or I sent it to to Gary.
Man, thank you.
And he's sending it on to you. You should have all of them.
Okay.
I think I got the crowd reaction one. When your song came on and Gabino started to paint, but how cool would that be to do it live?
If you want to be part of our 9/11 name reading this year at Heroes Memorial Bridge here in Rockwall, I'm giving you the invite right now. If you have the time and you want to read some names, you are more than welcome to come out and read some names. Dave Bray last year came out. If you would like to come out this year, you have an open invitation.
Is that actually on the day of 9/11?
That's on 9/11. Yes, sir. Yep. I think we're doing it on 9/11.
To be perfectly honest with you, this is a huge blessing. I don't take it for granted, but we usually stay booked on 9/11. Like, couple years out, you know, because it's just our, I became the 9/11 guy.
I totally understand. Yeah, actually, 9/11 is on a Monday this year. We'll probably end up doing it so it's conducive for everybody September 10th.
Oh, I may give you guys a holler then if that's what happens, because I mean, sometimes we work right through that weekend and have something on every day, and then sometimes, you know, it's just a big event on that. It would be Monday, that I guess. So, but yeah, I'll keep an eye on it, and
okay.
And I'll be watching y'all too. So,
thank you so much,
Darryl. I'd love that, man.
Well, we appreciate you calling. Appreciate for you standing up for us and really taking. You know, taking us under your wing, man, and through your voice. It is wonderful. So I want you to have a blessed day. Blessings to the family. Keep rocking, bro.
Keep writing.
All right, man. Thank you guys so much.
Stay well.
All right. Y'all too, man.
Thanks. Man, Darryl Worley, man. Have you forgotten? Called in, man. That is wow. That was amazing.
I say there's some things worth fighting for. What about our freedom and this piece of ground? We didn't get to keep 'em by backing down. They say